Kojo.
Are India's constitutional values really under threat? We'll talk about it. That's exactly the topic, ladies and gentlemen. And I've got two of the finest orators of the country, two that are definitely trending in the social media terms right now. Two people who are, everybody is following at this point of time, especially in the times that we are in our country. So we will have them on the stage to fire this up. Once again, I will request everybody to refrain from movement during this session and relish and enjoy the session. Let's go ahead. Okay, so we are ready. Let me invite, start by inviting in the man who needs no introduction, but I will take this moment. An Indian politician, economist, statistician, serves as a nominated member of Parliament in Rajya Sabha. Put your hands together for Mr. Subramanian Swamy. Kojo. Along with him, put your hands together for Mr. Asaduddin Owaisi, Parliamentarian of India and President of AIMIM. Welcome, sir. और इस सेशन को मॉडरेट करने के लिए भी एक खास शख्सियत की जरूरत थी तो हम बुलाना चाहते हैं श्री साई दीपक को who is an engineer turned law firm partner turned arguing counsel and once again a man who needs no introduction so over to this fantastic panel
so fortunately given the dignitaries present on the dais I don't think they need any introductions at all. In fact, it would be insulting to them to actually introduce them to the audience, given their track records which speak for themselves. Are India's constitutional values really under threat? Perhaps the operative word being really. And so here's the format that we are going to adopt. We give 5 minutes to each of the speakers to actually, or rather the debaters or perhaps discussants, depending on how the conversation goes, to give their opening remarks. Followed by a couple of questions from me based on their opening remarks. And after that, I will intersperse my questions with the questions that I get from the audience. I have only one request. Kindly observe rules of civility in the questions that you frame. The questions can certainly be provocative as long as the content is civil in language. Okay? So let's start with Dr. Swamy and hear him on his opening remarks with respect to the topic on constitutional values. Wherever he is, it's up to you.
Well, the issue that is posed is about constitutional values under threat now. That means that it wasn't under threat before. Would you say the state of the emergency that was declared, was that a threat or not? And the fact that in 1951, against the advice of Dr. Ambedkar and everybody else, Jawaharlal Nehru brought in an amendment which is called the First Amendment of the Constitution, where he said that liberty, freedom of speech, all will have to be subject to certain conditions. And a new article was inserted into the Constitution called 19(2), which now outlaws speaking about seditious matters. It outlaws protesting, which is of breaking laws. It's a whole lot of restriction which was not there in the original constitution adopted on the 26th of January 1950. So the threat to the constitution has been going on for a long time, but we also have noticed that people have struggled, fought against it. For instance, the emergency had to be withdrawn. And the people showed what democracy means to them because the most educated sections of India, that is South India, the four states of South India, voted for Mrs. Gandhi in the election, and the most uneducated part of India, which is North India, voted against Mrs. Gandhi and defeated her. So it's wrong to say that education is what prepares you for the Constitution. Most Indians have not read the Constitution. The Constitution has many things which I'm sure Mr. Owaisi will never agree is a constitutional value. For instance, Article 48 says there shall be a ban on cow slaughter. I'm not sure he will agree on that. Constitution Article 44 says there shall be uniform civil code. I don't know whether he'll agree to that. Article 351 of the Constitution says that Hindi, which will be the link language, shall have largely Sanskrit words and secondarily words from other languages. I don't think that many people in our sophisticated world would agree to that. So the real problem today is, what do you mean by constitutional values? Can you sit in dharna with children when the Juvenile Justice Act says that taking children to illegal demonstrations is a crime punishable by 7 years? I have not seen anybody being punished yet on this Shahdeen or whatever place demonstrations have taken place. So our liberty has gone much beyond the Constitution, and it is under no threat whatsoever. Thank you.
Mr. Owaisi.
Thank you. I have 5 minutes to make the introductory remarks. I am of the opinion that yes, there is a threat to the constitutional values. Mr. Swamy did not substantiate on what are the constitutional values. Number one is constitutionalism. That is, the Prime Minister is one among the equal. And I say that there's a threat to the values of constitution, that is constitutionalism, number one, because in the present political setup, the Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, is from 1 to 100, he is the only person, which contradicts that the Prime Minister is one amongst the equal. Secondly, what is the constitutional value? It is federalism. Now, here you have a classic case wherein a president rule was imposed in J&K, and through backdoor, a state was divided and converted into Union Territory. So this is the second example where there's a threat to the constitutional values. Third threat to constitutional values is, in our constitution, the preamble talks about, one, in the value system, justice, liberty, equality, fraternity. What we have seen now, when it comes to justice, the Honorable Supreme Court, in a recent judgment, especially in paragraph number 8, they say that the reservation is not a right, which the BJP agreed. In fact, the Constitution talks about justice in the preamble to bring equality among the people who have been discriminated. This is the third example wherein the constitutional values are being threatened. The fourth example is freedom of expression. Freedom of expression is a fundamental right in our constitution, which can rightly be called a constitutional value. You have seen, I have seen, you have read how under the pressure of this government, many editors have been changed of various newspapers and portals. I'll give an example of how liberty is threatened. You have a school headmistress and a parent of a daughter who were charged under sedition and put in prison because the daughter of that woman, who's a widow, had said something against the Prime Minister. So the mother was punished and the headmistress was punished, and they were lodged in jail for a period of 2 weeks. That is a threat to liberty. So these are important issues. There is a definite threat to the constitutional values, and no one can deny that. So and the last and important point is that when I say there's a threat to the constitutionalism, that is, we have separation of powers, which is again part of a basic structure of a constitution. Here you have a Prime Minister who has weakened legislature, who has weakened judiciary, and now what we hear is that the Prime Minister is a genius. I don't agree with that statement. In fact, I can say Mr. Swamy is a genius, But he took wrong decisions, wrong political decisions throughout his life. That is his systematic wrong-making decision. And please remember, constitutional values are fundamental rights. They are not directive principles. And to counter the point of Mr. Swamy, as far as protection of cow is concerned, when the constitution was being drafted, it included Mr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. The constitution doesn't talk about the Hindu values. When it comes to protection of cow, the constitution talks about economy, how it should be protected. Thank you.
So I've been made a specific request that as much as possible, if we could speak in both English and Hindi for the benefit of the audience, that would help. Sure, great, okay. So I'll start with my first question. I'm so sorry.
No, this is the culture of India that all three South Indians are sitting and you're asked to speak in Hindi. Good.
Just a small correction, sir. I'm an Indian from the South, not a South Indian.
Indian from South. Okay. Good.
So. So I'll start with my first question to Dr. Swamy. Since the topic of the debate happens to be constitutional values, I remember you making a statement, and in fact, perhaps you've even written on it, that the constitution at the heart of it is a dharmic document, and it sees India as a Hindu Rashtra. And I suppose that this entire statement or conclusion comes from your experience with handling constitutional law and having read it. For the sake of the audience, could you please enlighten us as to what is the basis of this statement? Because I've read the constitution debates myself, and I'd like to understand your position on this.
First of all, I must repeat again, this topic that you have framed, the critical word is now. And whatever Mr. Owaisi said, while I don't disagree with it, but I will say this has been happening all through the last 70 years. But he is only bothered about the last 5 years. That is the problem. The threat to the constitution will always be there because we are a country which has come through out of imperialism and foreign invasions, and therefore this process of becoming your mindset to being prepared for abiding by the constitution is going to take time, and that means through struggle. So therefore, this word, if you were to ask me, this debate was badly framed because you used the word now. So once you have dropped the word now, I'll come to this question. First of all, I will also say that the directive principles are not, an individual citizen cannot go to court and say, these directive principles I want to enforce because it is my fundamental right. True. But it also says the provisions contained in this part, which is the directive principle, shall not be enforceable by any court, but the principles therein laid down are nevertheless fundamental to the governance of the country, and it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. So it is not a fundamental right of mine, but it is binding on the government to implement it. So it is a mandatory provisions, number one. Number two, when I spoke about this question of this being already a Hindu Rashtra's constitution, I don't need a new constitution, because people were saying there should be a new Hindu Rashtra constitution. I said, why? It's already there. All that the Hindu Rashtra would require is already there. First of all, in the preamble, they have said faith is a fundamental right. So in this Ram Janmabhoomi, we won the case because my petition, which came in and said that my faith is that Ram was born here and that I have a fundamental right to pray there. Whereas a mosque is a place to read namaz, and namaz can be read anywhere, including in my drawing room, even on this place. So this distinction showed that we were able to use the word faith for a religious purpose which is dear to us. Second, Uniform Civil Code has to be enforced by the government. That's what the Constitution says. Protection of cow is here. It's not on agriculture. It's a ban on cow slaughter. I'll read it out because Owaisi is a highly educated lawyer. So lawyers never tell the truth. So let me read out what exactly it says. And so that there is no doubt in this at all. 48. Protection, improvement of environment and safeguarding of forests and wildlife. The state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and safeguard the forest with life, etc. Then it goes on to say that the state shall endeavor to organize agriculture, animal husbandry on modern and scientific lines and shall in particular take steps to preserving, improving the breeds and prohibiting the slaughter of cows and calves. So prohibiting the slaughter of cows. They haven't said buffaloes, they haven't said pigs, they haven't said any of the other things. So that similarly, I pointed out to you about Article 351 Sanskrit. This is another Hindu Rashtra demand. Devanagari shall be the script that shall be used in Hindi and not any other script. That's also a Hindu Rashtra demand. And throughout, I will show every place wherever there is a Hindu Rashtra demand. Hindus can never want that all should have follow Hinduism. All religions lead to God, so we have no difficulty if there are Jews here, there are Parsis here, there are Christians here, there are Muslims here, and they want to worship, we will allow it. Do they want to build a masjid? Of course, they have a right to build it. There are Muslim countries where I can't build a temple, but this country you can build as many mosques you want. So that is the issue.
So I have a question for you, sir.
So you don't want to reply to him?
You can respond to him after I ask my question. Yeah? Okay. So from what I understand, and please correct me if I've got the history wrong, AIMIM is the successor organization to the MIM, which
no.
was...
No.
It was not? I
no.
see. So it was started by Mr. Qasim Rizvi, who fled
no.
to Pakistan in
no,
1957.
No, you got your history and facts wrong.
I thought he was for the support of the creation of a South
no.
Pakistan,
no.
which is the Hyderabad princely state.
This,
let me just finish my question.
No, let me finish my question.
You can correct me. I'll allow you to correct me. So my question is, as a party, which assume for a moment it's a misplaced conception or it's a misplaced assumption, which sees itself as the legal successor of MIM.
No, we don't.
I'd like to understand.
No, your question is
how
wrong.
Have you managed to chart your journey from an entity which was for the creation of Pakistan to an entity which supports
wrong.
The Constitution of India? Just explain
you're,
that to
you're
us.
You're factually wrong.
Okay, please go ahead, explain.
So, I don't know which history books you have read, but I can give you some good history books to correct your understanding of history. This is a political party which has no relation whatsoever with the earlier MIM. This is AIMIM. People who had who were called Razakars, they went to Pakistan. We have no connection whatsoever with the Razakars or with that MIM, which is called. This was a party which was established and registered in the Election Commission of India. We started our political journey in 1958 onwards. And when you register a political party, you have to subscribe and accept to India's constitution. And that is how this political journey has started from 1958 onwards.
Okay. So since you mentioned that under this particular government, there has been a lot of, let's say, sabotage as far as the constitution is concerned, I remember that Sri Salahuddin Owaisi, your father, was a contemporary of Indira Gandhi. So I'm trying to understand what was the position taken by your party as an organization towards the policies of Ms. or Mrs. Indira Gandhi during her regime, especially during emergency and subsequently.
Well, you see, these are journeys wherein sometimes you are in a weather of winter or autumn. So, you know, politicians have to travel to various weathers. We supported Mrs. Gandhi, we opposed her, and this has been the reality. And that is why even Mrs. Gandhi came to our party office for the Secunderabad by-election. Mr. Shiv Shankar was contesting. So she came to our office, and we supported her at that time. Then we opposed her as well. And now I am a bitter opponent of Congress, and that is why I carry this baggage of being B team, C team, I don't know which team it is. So this is what politics continues.
I see. You wanted to respond to Dr. Swamy's point.
Okay, now yes. To respond to Dr. Swamy's point about calling constitution a Hindu Shastra, right?
Hindu Rashtra. He says it validates the concept of Hindu Rashtra.
Hindu Rashtra.
Yes.
For me, the constitution is not a religious book. It is not even a piece of literature. And for me, religious text is what? That governs my relationship with my God, who I believe in. Constitution, that is not the case with the Constitution. The Constitution is a legal text which says that India has no religion. India has no religion. India celebrates all the religions. In fact, India even celebrates people who don't believe in God. So on that point, Mr. Swamy is wrong. Secondly, Mr. Swamy read from the Constitution. He's reading some directive principles. What is the word he used? The state shall endeavor. Now, as a legal student, I'm not a legal luminary, Mr. Swamy. He's a rightful successor of Lord Denning. I can say that. So the word shall and word may means is mandatory. The word shall is not mandatory. Endeavor. Now, endeavor, when it comes to endeavor, is it compulsory in the government? No. And when you talk about, sir, when you talk about that cow slaughter, you read earlier, can I just pass me that? Let 1 minute. I could have got it. See, when it comes to cow slaughter, what it is under directive principle of organization of agriculture and animal husbandry. Organization of agriculture and animal husbandry. So where is the question of acceding to the Hindu religion over here? And please remember then when constitution was being made, Shama Prasad Mukherjee was there. And then Mr. Swamy talks about directive principles. He talked about uniform civil code. Let me read 51B. To cherish and follow the noble ideals which inspired our national struggle for freedom. He is against protest. How did we get our freedom had we not protested? And didn't Ms. Swamy's party protest with Anna Hazare? You did protest. You did protest. I mean, not you in not person. You don't come out on roads, you go to courts.
Yes.
But there was a protest. There was a protest. And then you talk about directive principles, sir. You know, for uniform civil code, what will be the uniform civil code, please tell me. Can you reconcile the Dayabhaga and Mitakshara school of thought? Can you ensure that the Hindu undivided family tax rebates are given to every religion? Isn't that contradicting right to equality? And moreover, sir, you're an economist. Please tell me, sir, I want one answer from you. This present government, how much allocation has been made for protection of cow?
May I? Yeah, please.
Shall I speak in Hindi now? Or?
Sure. Absolutely. Please.
No compulsion. All right. Hindi. Ab aadha Hindi, aadha Angrezi. Angrezi ho gaya hai, to baaki sab Hindi mein ab. Yahan jo likha hai, us wo jo inhone padha hai, usse bhin hai. इसमें लिखा है जहां तक गौ हत्या पर प्रतिबंध के सवाल पर shall in particular take steps for preserving and improving the breed, okay, no problem, and prohibiting the slaughter of, not strive to prohibit or strive to, prohibiting the slaughter of cows and calves and drought cattle. So let me finish.
You complete, sir.
Second, you say this is not a religious document, but it's a secular document, and we believe, and what the Constitution says, that all religions are equal. As a Muslim, do you agree that Hinduism can lead to God as much and as efficiently as Islam?
I agree. Can I answer on you on that? I started my initial remarks by saying that India has no religion. India celebrates all religion. India celebrates all religion. You are entitled to your religious belief. I am entitled to my religious belief. And no one can interfere in your practice of your religion, neither in my practice of religion.
But that doesn't answer his question.
No, I am answering his question.
Please.
That is his belief. I agree to his belief. My belief is different. He has to agree to my belief.
Yes.
That is what I'm telling you. This is the beauty of our constitution, that you cannot superimpose my views or my views on him.
No, I think the question is whether one belief undermines or comes in the way of the other.
No.
So let's not obfuscate
yes. Not at all. Not at all. Not at all.
Yes.
Not at all. Everyone is entitled to their beliefs. Okay. Please go ahead with your beliefs. Do not superimpose and make this country a Hindu Rashtra. Mm. Do not make this country a country of one religion or one culture or one language.
Fantastic. So, since you raised that point, and I'm assuming that
please. You talk about cow slaughter, sir. Yeah. Sir, you are in power in all the Northeast states. Can you please bring a bill over there? Why are you not doing it?
I'll tell you. I'll tell
please
you.
Do it, sir.
I'll tell you. You have repeatedly said this many times. We Hindus believe that the breed called Bos Indicus is the sacred cow. The cow in Northeast is Bos Taurus. We have no reason to protect them. And Bos Indicus is the only breed that we shall protect as sacred. And Northeast is free to eat the cow. They call it cow, but it is not a cow.
So may I? For the change, I mean, for the flavor of change, let's just move away from certain bovine topics, right?
No, I didn't start it.
So let me just ask you. So since you seem to have a fundamental problem with the concept and idea of a Hindu Rashtra, and I'm assuming that you have a problem with it after understanding what it is about, could you please explain for my understanding and for the audience's understanding as to what do you understand by the word Rashtra? How is it the same as Rajya, or is Rashtra the... Is it different from Rajya, or is it the same as Rajya? Could you please explain that for us?
You see, the word nation has been used...
Agar aap chahe to Hyderabad yurt mein bhi baat kar sakte hain, sir.
The word nation has been used in the preamble.
I'm talking about Hindu Rashtra.
No. I'm happy with that.
Right. You're happy with that? Okay.
When you talk about Hindu Rashtra, then you go to the Savarkar's ideology, what he wrote, that Muslims and Christians do not believe because India is not a holy land or their Putrabhumi or Matrabhumi, right?
Pitrabhumi.
Yeah, exactly, that is right there. When you talk about Hindu Rashtra, then you go back to what Golwalkar said in 1930s. Mm. He said that if Muslims have to live in India, they should be denied citizenship right, which one step has been taken under CAA now. Mm. When you talk about Hindu Rashtra, it was the RSS, Let me answer,
hold
and
on,
you can,
on.
Or you can come and sit here. It was.
I would request members of the audience to maintain decorum, and trust me, all questions will be asked. Please.
It is the Hindu Rashtra. When you ask Hindu Rashtra, is that it took RSS after it was banned to accept in writing that they will accept even the national flag. When the national flag came out, there is an article signed by RSS people, an organizer, that they say we do not believe in these three colors because it is inauspicious.
It still doesn't answer my question as
to what is
the meaning of Rashtra according to
you. I am explaining, sir, do you...
What is Rashtra according to you?
That is what is Rashtra.
To change
India's diversity, to change India's pluralism, and to make it a nation of one religion, wherein one religion has domination, to change the basic structure of the constitution, that's it.
May I?
Please.
Do you agree that in English there's a distinction between nation and country?
I am speaking about in the Indian context.
Very
context.
Very straightforward question.
No, I am straightforward giving answer.
There's a distinction between
nation
and country.
I am giving you a straightforward answer in relation to India.
Right.
I am giving you that answer. I am not concerned about what Her Majesty the Queen does.
Fine. So let me ask this question. When it comes to interpretation of non-Hindu religions in India under law or in any of the Islamic seminaries, which book which traces its origins to India is relied upon for interpretation of either Islamic law or Christian canon law? I'm trying to ask myself this simple question since you're saying...
No, I please explain to me
in more detail. Simple kar deta hun.
Okay, kar dijiye.
Jab aap fatwa jari karte hain, and I'm using the word fatwa as a legal finding, a judicial finding, not in the negative sense. Hmm. Okay?
It is an advisory. It's not an advisory.
Chahe wo advisory
Supreme
ho
Court
ya binding
has said
ho,
it's an advisory.
Yeah. So the question is, Bharat ke kaun se book mein se aap apne, let's say, interpretation ko dhoondte hain? My point is, everything that relates to Islam necessarily comes from a book and commentaries which do not originate in India. Okay. Would that be a correct statement to make?
You're absolutely wrong.
Oh, please
tell me. You don't know.
Sahih al-Bukhari was authored in India.
Do you know Fatwa-e Alamgiri?
Go ahead, please.
Alamgiri?
Oh, so you use Fatwa-e Alamgiri to actually...
Listen to me. Where was Fatwa-e Alamgiri written?
No. The question is, when you issue a fatwa, do you use the Quran or what are you using?
Are you debating with me or an anchor?
I am asking you a straightforward
question. You want to debate with me? I'll answer you.
I am asking you a straightforward question.
I am answering you in a straightforward way. Please listen to me. You have...
Should I rephrase the question for you to understand better?
I understood where you're coming from.
Answer, please.
Do you believe that the Islamic law is only Quran and Sunnah? No, you're absolutely wrong.
Go ahead, please explain.
No, it is not.
Right.
It is Quran, it is Sunnah,
right.
It is the judicial or the fatwas given.
Hadith.
It is, Sunnah is Hadith only.
Hadith only.
Then you have schools of thought.
Right.
Hanafi, Shafi, Maliki, Fiqh. Then you have Fatwa-e Alamgiri. There are so many books.
So
you
these know, schools of thought, what is the basis of the schools of thought? Is the
every religion, every school of thought.
Right. Basically, has the audience understood the question? Oh, okay, great.
No, listen.
Yes, please.
Fantastic.
Right.
Majority of Indian Muslims are Hanafis.
Right. Okay.
We follow Fatwa-e Alamgiri.
Okay.
And that protection, where it comes from? Article 26.
Okay.
Isn't it?
And what is the basis of Fatwa-e Alamgiri?
Fatwa-e Alamgiri is the opinion of the Islamic scholars who were born in India.
Based on what?
Based on Quran and Sunnah.
Thank
and
you.
Also advice.
Thank
also,
you.
Also, all, listen, no. If you don't find an answer in Quran and Sunnah, then that is what the scholars give their opinion.
Right. Okay. So, please.
Well, the fundamental question is, when you talk about secularism, is either you say I will tolerate all other religions, but my religion is superior, or you will say what the Hindus say, that all religions lead to God. Islam does not believe that all religions lead to God, neither does Christianity.
Is that a political statement or a theological statement?
It is based on theology, because he may be a Muslim.
You can respond.
He is a Muslim, I have no doubt about that.
Right.
But in Saudi Arabia, you can't even celebrate Diwali. You cannot keep a picture of Ramchandraji in your pocket. You cannot have Satyanarayan Puja inside your house. If you bring any idol from India and they detect you in the customs area, they'll put you in jail for 5 days. So there is a clear, and I have spoken to Saudi Arabians, they say this is our religion.
But what do you make of the other countries in the Middle East which are slowly encouraging the opening of temples?
Only one religion, one state, and that is Dubai, and that is UAE, and that too for Swami Narayan.
Right.
They have not agreed to a Shiva temple.
So are they not Islamic republics?
No, I am only asking him.
Right.
That would he say that Hinduism leads to God just as much as Islam leads to God? He will not be able to say that, because the theology will prevent him from that.
I'll let you respond to
that. And if
he
says it, then you'll have to give him Z security protection.
So we'll come back to Mr. Owaisi. You will specifically get to answer that question. I won't deprive you of that opportunity. So one question for you, sir.
Yes.
So Mr. Owaisi believes that the repealment and amendment of Article 370, it's not an abrogation entirely, it's an amendment of Article 370, is effectively an act of subversion of the Constitution.
Oh.
So I'm asking myself this question as a layperson for a moment, keeping my legal experience aside.
Ji.
What was India expected to do to put an end to the problem with respect to Article 370? If status quo was not a solution, what is it that India could have done? Is there an option other than what the government has done?
There are two places. I'll speak in Hindi.
Please, sir, please.
दो जगह में आपको यहाँ से उस आपको संकेत मिलती है कि क्या कदम उठाना चाहिए. पहला है कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली. कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली में कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली ने पूरा संविधान का जो काम था वो 26 नवंबर 1949 तक पूरा कर दिया था. 16 नवंबर को एक नया अमेंडमेंट लाया गया कि आर्टिकल 370 इसमें जोड़ा जाए. अंबेडकर ने कहा मैं गद्दार नहीं हूँ इसीलिए मैं नहीं मूव करूँगा, यद्यपि वो चेयरमैन थे. तो फिर गोपाल स्वामी आयंगर जो कश्मीर में रीजेंट थे उनको बुलाकर उनको मूव करने के लिए किया. बहुत ज़बरदस्त विरोध हुआ तो सरदार पटेल खड़े होकर कहा जवाहरलाल नेहरू यूएन चले गए और वो थोड़े दिन में वहाँ पूरा समाधान हो जाएगा, उसके बाद इसको हटा देंगे. तो संविधान में एक ही आर्टिकल है जिसमें लिखा है कि राष्ट्रपति की विज्ञप्ति से इसको रद्द किया जा सकता है. मैं पढ़ सकता हूँ बट तो मैं बता रहा हूँ. और हेडलाइन में लिखा है टेम्पररी प्रोविजन टू द स्टेट ऑफ जम्मू कश्मीर. जम्मू कश्मीर में भी एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूंट असेंबली थी जिसने एक जम्मू कश्मीर के लिए कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बनाया. उसमें इन्होंने लिखा, उसमें लिखा है कि जम्मू एंड कश्मीर इज एन इंटेग्रल पार्ट ऑफ इंडिया. 370 का कोई लिंक है ये सब कुछ किसी कहीं भी लिखा नहीं है. तो जब टेम्पररी प्रोविजन है इसको हम कैसे परमानेंट कर सकते हैं? और हमने कोई फतवा नहीं जारी किया, हमने पार्लियामेंट में बिल को लाए और ये यानी अप्रूवल बिल लाए. माने बिल तो ज़रूरत नहीं थी क्योंकि राष्ट्रपति ने विज्ञप्ति जारी कर दिया, बट उसको अप्रूव करने के लिए कि वी हाउस अप्रूव्स द राष्ट्रपति नोटिफिकेशन, वो ऐसा हम ला करके किया. सारे जो भी कुछ हमने किया हमने कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के हिसाब से किया. किसी ने उसको चैलेंज नहीं किया अभी सुप्रीम कोर्ट में, उसको कह के कि ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल नहीं है. तो सिर्फ ये कहना 370 ये इसमें कोई आधार नहीं है, इट वॉज टेम्पररी. 70 साल टेम्पररी रहा है, हम तो 5 साल में इसको ख़त्म कर दिया है.
right.
तो हम तो इसको असली टेम्पररी मानते थे, परंतु जो पहले सेक्युलर लोग थे वो इसको परमानेंट ही मानते थे.
तो 370 के ऊपर कश्मीर का एक स्पेशल स्टेटस है और वहां पर असेंबली को आपने डिसॉल्व कर दिया, असेंबली से ओपिनियन नहीं लिए, जबकि कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में जिक्र है कि कश्मीर, सुनिए आप, कश्मीर की असेंबली से लेना ओपिनियन आप नहीं लिए.
नॉट करेक्ट, नॉट करेक्ट.
नो यू सर, दिस इज अ मैटर ऑफ डिबेट व्हिच विल बी
डिबेटेड.
सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जाएगा ना सर, सुप्रीम कोर्ट जाएगा.
मैं पढ़ दूंगा.
आप असेंबली को डिसॉल्व करते हैं,
जा चुका है सुप्रीम कोर्ट ऑलरेडी,
जा चुका है, बहस चल रही है. अब नहीं मालूम मेरी जिंदगी में आएगा, आपकी जिंदगी नहीं मालूम. तो वो तो डिसॉल्व कर दी असेंबली. आप असेंबली डिसॉल्व करके आपने सब डिसीजन ले लिए, असेंबली की राय तक भी आपने नहीं ली वहां पर. अब रहा सवाल 370 का, आप ये बताइए कि वहां पर आप ये क्यों लॉ बनाने जा रहे हैं कि बाहर का आदमी जमीन नहीं खरीद सकता वहां पर.
राइट right.
क्यों बना रहे हैं आप?
गुड पॉइंट.
जबकि आर्टिकल 370 में तो इट बिकेम एन एम्प्टी शेल.
करेक्ट.
इट वॉज एन एम्प्टी शेल. एवरीथिंग वॉज यू नो आई डोंट मोर देन 100 आर्टिकल मोर देन 100 आर्टिकल्स वर ऑलरेडी इंप्लीमेंटेड. इट वॉज एन एम्प्टी शेल. वॉट वॉज देयर? Now you have taken 35A बोल रहे आप, 35A दोबारा कर रहे हैं आप कश्मीर में भी आप.
I completely agree with you कि 370 हटाने के बाद ये domicile status लाने का मतलब क्या है. I understand your point. My question is, अगर संविधान के इतने सारे अनुच्छेद ऑलरेडी लागू हो चुके हैं तो 370 होने से या ना होने से क्या फर्क पड़ता है?
370 एक स्पेशल स्टेटस कश्मीर का था जो 35A था उसमें. 35 था उसमें आप 35 निकाल दिया.
एक मिनट अगर आप, क्योंकि भारत में चाहे कोई भी धर्म या मजहब का हो वो प्रधानमंत्री बन सकता है, एंड दैट इज द ग्रेटनेस ऑफ दिस कंट्री थैंक्स टू इट्स सिविलाइजेशन. अगर आप प्रधानमंत्री बनते या आप बन जाते हैं फ्यूचर में, और मान लीजिए कि आपके टाइम तक 370 था, और ये मान लेते हैं कि भाजपा सरकार ने जो किया है वो पूरी तरह से गलत है, गैर संवैधानिक है, ये एक मिनट के लिए मान लेते हैं, तो आपके हिसाब से 370 का जो मसला है आप उसको कैसे सुलझाते, ये थोड़ा हमारे लिए समझा दीजिए. या फिर उसमें कोई मसला नहीं है आपके हिसाब से?
सबसे पहले तो मैं महबूबा मुफ्ती से अलायंस नहीं करता.
अच्छा, नहीं, मैं कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल सवाल कर रहा हूँ.
सुनिए,
मैं कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल सवाल कर रहा हूँ.
सुनिए, देखिए,
मेरा सवाल
सुनिए.
माय क्वेश्चन इज टू बैरिस्टर असदुद्दीन.
इसमें तो हम सहमत हैं आपसे.
ही अग्रीज विद यू.
थैंक यू. यू टू एग्री करे.
सो द ट्वेन इज फाइनली मेट. हां, प्लीज गो अहेड. यस,
ये आप मेरे को एक पॉलिटिशियन के तौर पर यहां बुलाए हैं. मैं जवाब दे रहा
हूं. वकील भी
मैं वकील नहीं हूं. वकील आप हैं, प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं आप.
ओके,
बहस करिए सुप्रीम कोर्ट
में. तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में मैं बेहतर बोलता हूं.
नहीं, ठीक है, सुनिए.
जी हां,
पहले तो मैं महबूबा मुफ्ती से अलायंस नहीं करता. मैं
जी,
आपने अलायंस किया महबूबा मुफ्ती से. आपने एक टर्म्स ऑफ एग्रीमेंट बोलिए या जो भी एक डॉक्यूमेंट बनाया उसमें आपने लिखा कि 370 पे हाथ नहीं लगाएंगे. ये तीसरा मैं ये करता कि वहां पर बातचीत होती, सबसे एक माहौल पैदा किया जाता. आप कुछ माहौल नहीं करे, कुछ बातचीत नहीं करे. आप ही के दौर में इतने टेररिस्ट अटैक्स हुए, इतने हमले हुए बीजेपी के दौर में, और इंटरनेट बैन माशाल्लाह यानी रिकॉर्ड बन गया अभी तो, और इकोनॉमी में कितना असर पड़ा उसके ऊपर. खुद इकोनॉमिक टाइम्स की रिपोर्ट है कि मोर देन 100 करोड़ के ऊपर का लॉस वहां पर हुआ.
जी.
तो 370 तो एक शेल था. और ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूं, जो आपके रॉ के दौलत साहब का स्टेटमेंट है, इट वॉज एन एम्प्टी शेल. आप लोग ये करके और हालात में कौन सा अच्छा करे आप, कौन सा करने जा रहे हैं आप? इलेक्शन नहीं करा सकते आप, इलेक्शन पोस्टपोन हो रहे, लोगों को गिरफ्तार कर रहे आप, कहां का रख रहे? आगरा की जेल में ला के रख रहे उन लोगों को आप, किधर रख रहे? इसका हल निकलने वाला है? मैं नहीं निकलने वाला हल इसका, और हालात खराब होंगे वहां पे.
तो 70 साल के बातचीत के बाद क्या हल निकला सर?
70 साल की बातचीत में
जी,
70 साल के दौर में
जी, आपके हिसाब से सिचुएशन बिगड़ा या बेहतर हुआ?
70 साल में पहली गलती जो हम लोग किए
जी,
वो शेख साहब की गिरफ्तारी थी.
अच्छा, ओके.
ये दूसरी गलती हम लोग किए.
अच्छा,
उसमें बीच में 1986-87 में एक फ्रॉजुलेंट इलेक्शन हुआ जिसका खामियाजा वहां पर भुगतना पड़ा
जी.
और ये चीज आप देख लीजिए, आप आज आपके पास वहां पे खामोशी है. कश्मीरी लोग बड़े चालाक होते हैं. बहुत चालाक होते हैं.
okay.
वो कभी भी रिएक्ट नहीं करेंगे जब आप चाहते. आप देख लो उनकी हिस्ट्री है पूरी.
ओके.
आप तो देखिए उसको.
नहीं, मैं तो कहता हूँ मद्रासी ब्राह्मण भी उनसे ज्यादा चालाक है. इसमें ये चालाकी का सवाल नहीं है
सर.
देखिए, पहले आप दोनों को मिक्स मत करिए. पहले तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल पोजीशन मैं पढ़ देता हूँ. उसमें कहीं नहीं असेंबली का जिक्र है. नॉट विथस्टैंडिंग एनीथिंग इन द फोरगोइंग प्रोविजंस ऑफ दिस आर्टिकल, द प्रेसिडेंट मे बाय पब्लिक नोटिफिकेशन declare that this article shall cease to be operative or shall be operative only with such exceptions and modifications and with from such date as maybe he may specify, provided that the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly of the state referred to in clause 2 shall be necessary before the president issues such a notification. Now Constituent Assembly completed its deliberation and presented a constitution. In that there is no reference to Article 370. There is only one in the preamble which says that Jammu Kashmir is an integral part of India, and there is no question of consulting the Assembly.
Swami Sahab, Jammu Kashmir yakinan Hindustan ka toot hissa hai aur rahega. वहां पर कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली की जो बात आई है, आप उसको प्रेसिडेंट को अख्तियार नहीं है. मेरा मानना यह है प्रेसिडेंट को अख्तियार नहीं है असेंबली को डिसॉल्व करके आप आप स्टेट को डिवाइड करके यूनियन टेरिटरी नहीं बना सकते, मेरा स्टैंड है। अब ये सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जाएगा।
आपका स्टैंड है या वकील के तौर पे आपका स्टैंड
नहीं है? ये मेरा स्टैंड इसलिए क्योंकि मैंने लीगल जो लुमिनरीज है उनसे जो पढ़ा है, उनके आर्टिकल्स पढ़े हैं और उनको सुना है और उनसे उनकी बुनियाद पर कह रहा हूं मैं आपको।
तो आप हरीश सालवे साहब को लीगल लुमिनरी मानते हैं?
हरीश सालवे से बेहतर मैं समझता हूँ फैजान मुस्तफा को, हरीश सालवे से बेहतर मैं समझता हूँ आपके ऐसे कई लॉयर से। अब हरीश सालवे साहब ओपिनियन लिख के दिए थे 370 का,
तो जाहिर है वकील हैं, आपने उनसे पूछा?
नहीं नहीं, वो अकेले नहीं है, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल एक्सपर्ट नहीं है वो।
ओके,
नहीं मैं आपसे कहता हूँ, आप कहते हैं कश्मीरी बहुत चालाक हैं और वो लड़ेंगे ऐन वक्त पर, मैं कहता हूँ कि जब 5 लाख कश्मीरी पंडितों को भगाया और उनके नरसिंगार किया तो तब वहाँ कश्मीरी लोग क्या कर रहे थे?
स्वामी साहब वो मैं तो गुजारिश करूँगा कि एक एक कश्मीरी पंडित को लेकर जाकर कश्मीर में सेटल कराने की जिम्मेदारी आपकी सरकार की है।
अच्छा,
और 5 साल में आपने कितने कश्मीरी पंडित को लेकर गए ये बताइए। और मैं मानता हूँ कि कश्मीर का जो सिंक्रेटिक कल्चर है उसमें पंडित वहाँ पर जाना चाहिए और उम्मीद करते हैं कि वापस जाएंगे, लेकर जाइए जरूर।
सर जस्ट आउट ऑफ क्यूरियोसिटी, एज अ पार्टी आपने कश्मीरी पंडितों के सिलसिले में कोई रेजोल्यूशन अपने पार्टी के अंदर पास किया है?
आपकी मैं आपको रिसर्च फिर से नहीं कर रही, पार्लियामेंट में स्पीच है मेरी।
जी जी बोलिए प्लीज।
उसमें मैंने ये मुतालबा किया कश्मीरी पंडित को लेकर जाइए वापस आप।
अच्छा,
पार्लियामेंट के स्पीच में आप देख लो, चेक कर लो।
फेयर इनफ। तो एज अ पार्टी आपका पोजीशन ये है कश्मीरी पंडित
बिल्कुल वापस जाना चाहिए, वापस जाना चाहिए।
ग्रेट, ओके। सो आपने अपने ओपनिंग रिमार्क्स में सीए का जिक्र किया,
बट ये कश्मीरी नहीं है, तो कश्मीरी की बात कर रहे थे, कश्मीरी बहुत समझदार हैं, वो एंड वक्त पर एक्ट करेंगे, तो वो कश्मीरी क्यों नहीं बोलते हैं कि कश्मीरी पंडित वापस आ जाए? ये आप बोल रहे हैं, वो नहीं बोल रहे हैं।
नहीं, बहुत से कश्मीरी बोले हैं सर, बहुत, खुद महबूबा मुफ्ती बोली आपके मोदी के साथ खड़े रहे।
वो महबूबा मुफ्ती का गूगली बोलते डालते रहती है, इसीलिए तो मैंने कहा कि इसके साथ नहीं सरकार नहीं बनाना चाहिए।
नहीं सर, अब कौन किसको गूगली डाले वो तो नहीं मालूम।
सो मे आई प्रोसीड माय क्वेश्चंस? यस। सो ऑन द सीए, सो सिंस यू रिप्रेजेंट अ सिग्निफिकेंट पोर्शन ऑफ हैदराबाद व्हिच हैज अ सिग्निफिकेंट मुस्लिम पॉपुलेशन, व्हिच हैदराबादी मुस्लिम अकॉर्डिंग टू यू इज गोइंग टू बी अफेक्टेड बाय द सीए एंड व्हाई लीगली?
When I said all three are South Indians, you said I'm an Indian from South. So now let me tell you that any law which is passed, which is unconstitutional, which goes against the basic structure of the constitution, it will affect every Indian, irrespective of Hyderabadi Hindu, Hyderabadi Muslim or Hyderabadi Christian.
Right.
That is the first answer.
Right.
Secondly, why do we oppose CAA? Because in the 70 years of our Indian Lok Sabha, not a single law has been made on the basis of religion. This has been done. It, in my opinion, and in the opinion of many legal luminaries, which you will again ask which name, is that it violates right to equality. Fourthly, this country cannot have two principles of citizenship. Fifth, about CAA, it is discriminatory and it violates Article 14 of equality, because in Assam NRC has been done. 19 lakh people names did not come in the Assam NRC. Out of that, only 5 lakh were Muslims. The BJP intends to give citizenship to all those non-Muslims and not to the Muslims. Why? Again, all of them are illegal migrants because they didn't come. Isn't that a violation of Article 14? And last point, CAA has to be looked through the prism of NPR and NRC, because it relates to Citizenship Act. These are the rules which were framed when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was in power. That is why we oppose CAA, NPR, NRC, and please don't exclude me from your thought of India.
So I'm assuming that you're equally for Ahmadiyya Muslims from Pakistan for their entry into India. Is that the position?
I am saying you removed the word religious minorities and bring everyone. So who's stopping you?
So here's my question.
Yeah.
If I may, so sorry. The treatment that Razakars under the Nizam meted out to Hindus in Hyderabadi Pinsli state is the same treatment that
Hindus... No, you are jumping from CAA. Look, my answer has touched a raw nerve in you. My answer has touched a raw nerve in you.
Take me.
Now, look at your thought process. From CAA, you can drink water if you want.
From CAA,
you have jumped to Razakar.
My point is...
Listen to me.
You're turning into a debater from a moderator.
You're not a moderator.
I'm asking you a question.
You are trying to become another Subramanian Swamy, which will never happen in his life.
I agree that there can never be another Dr. Swamy, and I don't aspire to be him as well. Let me just ask this question. Aap sawal se itna kyun darr rahe hain? Mujhe to sawal to puchne
hai. Baithao, sir.
Sir, tum mujhe puchne dijiye na.
Main is program mein isliye aaya hoon, kyunki mere ko maloom hai poore RSS ke log baithe hue isliye aaya hoon.
We appreciate your guts. Absolutely.
No,
here's my thing. One, to be fair to the audience, I think the audience... I think the audience has been fairly open to both points of view. कि जो ट्रीटमेंट रजाकर ने हैदराबादी हिंदुओं के साथ किया था पाकिस्तान में हिंदुओं के साथ वही हो रहा है देयरफॉर देयर इज अ स्पेसिफिक पर्सिक्यूशन व्हिच इज बेस्ड ऑन रिलीजन जब प्रॉब्लम का बेसिस ही रिलीजन है तो सॉल्यूशन का बेसिस रिलीजन क्यों नहीं हो सकता ये थोड़ा समझा दीजिए
इसलिए नहीं हो सकता
जी
इसलिए नहीं हो सकता क्योंकि भारत का कोई रिलीजन नहीं है
अच्छा उनका तो रिलीजन है
भारत का नहीं है
जो मर रहे हैं उनका तो रिलीजन है
भारत का रिलीजन नहीं है आप मेरे को मालूम आपको पाकिस्तान की बड़ी मोहब्बत है मेरे को नहीं है पाकिस्तान से सुनिए आपको पाकिस्तान से बड़ी मोहब्बत है अफगानिस्तान से है आपको बांग्लादेश से मुझे नहीं है सर मुझे भारत से मतलब है और हमेशा रहेगा रहा सवाल पर्सिक्यूशन का आप पर्सिक्यूशन के ऊपर लेके आइए ना कौन रोक रहा आपको कौन रोक रहा है
तो तो लेट्स आस्क असल दिस क्वेश्चन रिकॉग्नाइज पर्सिक्यूशन बट इग्नोर द कॉज ऑफ द पर्सिक्यूशन इज द सॉल्यूशन
Persecution is persecution. Now,
explain that to me.
Listen to me, please. अगर कोई हिंदू पाकिस्तान से आकर भारत में रिफ्यूजी बनता है, तो मुझे उसका गम नहीं है.
रिफ्यूजी तभी बन सकता है जब वो persecuted है.
सर,
और मैं वकील हूँ. वकील के तौर पे एक पॉइंट बोलने.
अच्छा, रूल्स में बताइए. अब ये CAA रूल्स में डिफाइन कर रहे.
क्या
persecution डिफाइन कर रहे?
अगर वो रिलीजियस पर्सिक्यूशन हो चुका
है डिफाइन ही नहीं कर रहे ना.
आपने डॉक्यूमेंट्स देखे?
देखे. मेरी एक बात सुनिए. पाकिस्तान से कोई हिंदू आता है अफगानिस्तान से आता है बांग्लादेश से आता है कहीं से भी आता है लीजिए आप रिलीजन के ऊपर कानून क्यों बनाए आप एक्सक्लूड क्यों कर रहे
हैं ये राइट टू इक्वालिटी के खिलाफ है कोई अंतर करता है तो कानून अनकॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल है एक मार रहा है और दूसरा मर रहा है आपके हिसाब से कानून दोनों के बीच में अंतर नहीं कर सकता है थैंक यू आई अंडरस्टैंड दैट्स योर अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन एंड आई अंडरस्टैंड यू आर नो मोर अ लॉयर सो आई एम विद यू ओके सो लेट्स टेक वन और टू क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम द ऑडियंस यस सर प्लीज
Just one correction. He mentioned Article 14.
Right.
Said is equality before the law. There are a number of Supreme Court judgments which interpret Article 14. But I will not read them. I'll give you a very simple example and ask him how he would treat that example. Today there is reservation for scheduled castes in jobs, in education. But there are no reservations for Brahmins. So can I say equality before the law? I should also get reservation if scheduled caste gets reservations. This question came before the Supreme Court. And what did the Supreme Court say? Article 14 would apply only when invidious discrimination is meted out to equals. And similarly circumstanced people without any rational basis or relationship in that behalf. Now, in this particular case, these people who have come from Pakistan, and they were originally, there was a statement of Mahatma Gandhi in the prayer meeting that he would like to see the partition undone, and that he plans to go in February. That is a few days before his assassination, so he could not go. Therefore, he said, those who are there can stay there. But after that, Gandhiji was assassinated. Then Jawaharlal Nehru had a meeting with the Prime Minister of Pakistan called Laikat Ali Khan, and both resolved that the minorities of both countries will not leave because they'll be safe, they'll be protected. But Laikat Ali Khan was assassinated. And after that, the persecution started. And when this, these religions, this is not only Hindu religion, Hindu, Sikhs, Buddhists, Christians and Parsis. Five religions are there. The persecution started, they were 30% of Pakistan's population, and slowly over a period of time, they have now come down to 3%. And therefore, these persecuted people who have been coming from 1947 onwards have been living in camps because they have been treated as stateless, they have been treated as illegal immigrants, they can't get an Aadhaar card, they can't get a passport, so they have to get a dole from the government and live in tents. So in order to end this, and the last person who urged us, in this, for which we have a tape, Manmohan Singh, as leader of the opposition in Rajya Sabha, said, please, Mr. Advani, please have some kindness for these people and give them citizenship. And therefore, that is what all we did. It is only restricted to that group of 31,313 in which no Muslim came from Pakistan saying that he's being religiously persecuted. Other Muslims who came, we offered them citizenship on the individual basis, like Tariq Fateh. He said no, he'll take a Canadian citizenship. Taslima, she took a Swedish citizenship. But Adnan Sami, he took Indian citizenship, and everybody is criticizing us for giving him citizenship.
Right.
So therefore, please don't connect this with equality. Article 14 does not apply here at all. It is no question of being unequals being treated as equals.
If Mr. Owaisi wants to say something, please have the last word.
I just want to know from you. So you feel that the recent Supreme Court judgment on reservation is right?
What did they say? That I didn't follow it.
They said what you just said.
Promotion.
Appointment and promotion.
No, appointment they did not say.
They said, sir, in paragraph 21.
Then I'll have to,
In paragraph 21, they did say
no,
that.
No, we'll have another debate because you're all the time misquoting, so I've got to make sure that you're not mis...
I never misquote, sir. I'm telling you, paragraph 8, your government agreed. Paragraph 21,
next
they
debate,
said in
next
appointment...
Debate.
Okay, thank you.
It's always a pleasure to debate you, so thank I'm you. Ready for
sure,
another
sir.
Debate.
So, on behalf of the organizers and the audience, I thank both participants, especially Mr. Owaisi, for his patience with all the questions, and for the audience for putting up such a wonderful show. And I hope that I've done some justice to your questions, and Dr. Swamy, for all the time that you've given us. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Kojo.